Good morning, friends. Let's start with a pharmacology question paper. The question number one, what drug is used for the prophylaxis against pneumocystis jeroveci in patients on chemotherapy? Now, what is the drug treatment for pneumocystis jeroveci infection? Remember, the drug of choice for pneumocystis jeroveci is cotrimoxazole. So the correct answer for question number one is A, cotrimoxazole. Let's see what is the drug treatment for pneumocystis jeroveci infection. The drug of choice for pneumocystis is cotrimoxazole. And cotrimoxazole, it is the drug of choice for both treatment as well as prevention or prophylaxis. So the drug of choice for treatment as well as prophylaxis is cotrimoxazole. Now, in resistant cases of cotrimoxazole, the drug of choice is pentamidine, and it is only used for the treatment. And what is the route? It can be given through aerosols, which is the most preferred route. Aerosols of pentamidine is the most preferred route. It is the drug of choice for cotrimoxazole resistant cases. Now, what are the other drugs which are effective against cotrimoxazole? We will write, the other drugs are dapsone, which is also used in leprosy. Second is etobaquone, which is also used in malaria. Third is trimetrixate, which is a similar drug like methotrexate. Fourth is primaquine, another anti-malarial and anti-protozoal drug. And lastly, clindamycin. So these are the drugs which are effective against pneumocystis jeroveci infection. The drug of choice is cotrimoxazole, and in resistant cases, aerosols of pentamidine. Now let's come to question number two. Gum hyperplasia, hirsutism and pseudolymphoma is caused by ingestion of which drug? Phenobarbital, phenytoin, carbamazepine or diazepam? The correct answer for question number two is phenytoin. The correct answer is phenytoin. Now, phenytoin, we know it is an anti-epileptic drug. It is also used as an anti-arrhythmic drug. Class 1B anti-arrhythmic drug. It is also used in various neuralgic pain as well. Now, what are the adverse effects of phenytoin? The adverse effects of phenytoin, they can be divided into two. The adverse effect which are seen at high dose, also known as toxic effect, and there are certain adverse effect of phenytoin which is seen at normal dose as well. Okay, so these drugs, the adverse effect are divided into two, high dose and normal dose. In high dose, the adverse effect of phenytoin which is seen is, the first is cerebellar toxicity. Second is cerebral toxicity. And third is cardiotoxicity. It mainly causes bradycardia. In normal dose, we will write, it causes hirsutism, hyperplasia of gums, and hyperplasia of gums is the most common adverse effect of phenytoin. We will write hyperglycemia and weight gain. It also causes hyperglycemia and weight gain. It also causes Hodgkin's-like pseudolymphoma. Hodgkin's-like pseudolymphoma. It also causes hematological side effect like bleeding because of deficiency of vitamin K. It also causes anemia due to deficiency of folic acid. And it also causes Hydantoin syndrome in fetus, which is the teratogenic effect of phenytoin. Hydantoin syndrome in fetus, which mainly presents as cleft lip and cleft palate. So the correct answer for question number two is phenytoin. Question number three. Mechanism of oseltamivir or Tamiflu as an antiviral agent is, the correct answer for question number three is neuraminidase inhibition. Remember, oseltamivir is an anti-influenzal drug. Okay, it is an anti-influenzal drug. Now, if we talk about anti-influenzal drug, there are two kinds of anti-influenzal drug. The first is entry inhibitors, which inhibit the entry of virus into the cell, and exit inhibitors, which inhibit the release of virus from the cell. Now, entry inhibitor, the drugs are amantadine and rimantadine. Okay, amantadine and rimantadine. Now, what is their mechanism of action? They inhibit M2 protein receptor on the cell, and they inhibit the entry of virus into the cell, and they are only effective against influenza type A. Inhibit influenza type A. Now, exit inhibitor, the drugs are oseltamivir, which comes with a brand name known as Tamiflu. Other are zanamivir, perimavir, and leninamivir. It is the longest acting, leninamivir. Now, what is their mechanism of action? Mechanism of action is they inhibit a protein, neuraminidase, which is a component of this virus, neuraminidase inhibition. And if they inhibit neuraminidase, they inhibit the assembly of virus, and hence they inhibit release of virus, and they are effective against all influenza A, B, C, H1N1, H5N7, etc. And hence, these are the drug of choice. Neuraminidase inhibitor are the drug of choice for influenza, both for the treatment as well as prophylaxis. So the drug of choice for influenza is oseltamivir, which is the most commonly used drug. So the answer for the question number 3 is oseltamivir is a neuraminidase inhibitor. Now the question number 4th, etarnicept acts by one of the following mechanism: by blocking TNF, tumor necrosis factor, by blocking bradykinin synthesis, by blocking cyclooxygenase or COX enzyme, or by blocking lipoxygenase. The correct answer for question number 4, etarnicept, is, the answer is A. It blocks tumor necrosis factor. Etarnicept blocks tumor necrosis factor. Now let's talk about etarnicept. So etarnicept, it is a TNF inhibitor. Okay, now other properties of etarnicept, it is a fusion protein. Fusion protein means it is synthesized or engineered by fusing two different types of protein. Now how it is made? Sir, it contains a protein known as TNF alpha receptor type 2, which is linked to the Fc portion of IgG1 antibody. So this etarnicept, it contains Fc portion or constant region of immunoglobulin, that is IgG1, which is linked to a protein known as TNF alpha receptor type 2. When etarnicept is given, it binds with the TNF alpha, which is circulating in the plasma, and hence it inhibits the action or blocks the action of TNF alpha. Now, where it is used, what are the uses of etarnicept? Etarnicept is used in various autoimmune disease like rheumatoid arthritis and juvenile rheumatoid arthritis. It is also used in psoriasis, like psoriasis arthritis, and plaque psoriasis. It is also used in seronegative ankylosing spondylitis. And what are the side effects of etanercept? Etanercept cause reactivation of latent TB and HBV infection, because these infections are controlled or contained by TNF-alpha in our body. If we remove TNF-alpha, this TB and HBV infection, they gets reactivated. So the answer for question number 4th is A. Etanercept is a blocker of tumor necrosis factor. Now let's come to question number 5. Question number 5. Most effective bactericidal agents against Mycobacterium leprosy. Now if we, the options are erythromycin, ofloxacin, cotrimoxazole and amoxicillin. The correct answer for question number 5 is B. Ofloxacin. Ofloxacin is the correct answer. Now let's see what are the drugs for leprosy. Now the drug for leprosy, the first line drug. There are 3 first line drug and there are certain second line drug. The first line drug are 3. They are rifampicin, dapsone and clofazimine. Now among these 3 drug, rifampicin is bactericidal, while dapsone and clofazimine are bacteriostatic. They are bacteriostatic. Now second line drugs for leprosy are, we'll write a mnemonic, COME-CUM, that is clarithromycin and other macrolide as well. It is bacteriostatic. Then we have ofloxacin and other fluoroquinolone. It is bactericidal. Then we have a tetracycline known as minocycline. It is also bacteriostatic. And lastly, an TB drug also, anti-tubercular drug, ethambutol, it is also bacteriostatic. So among these drugs for leprosy, as we can see that the drugs rifampicin and ofloxacin are bactericidal agent, rest all other drugs are bacteriostatic. So the correct answer, the bactericidal agent is among them is ofloxacin. Okay, now let's come to the question number 6. All of the following antihypertensive drugs decreases plasma renin activity except clonidine, methyldopa, atenolol and chlorothiazide. The correct answer for question number 6 is D. Chlorothiazide. Now let's see how blood pressure is maintained. Let's see if there is fall in blood pressure or blood volume which is assessed by sodium. When there is fall in blood pressure, the brain, it increases certain compensatory mechanisms to restore the blood pressure level. It increases sympathetic discharge. This sympathetic discharge goes to the kidney, and on kidney it goes to the JG cells. This JG cells of the kidney, they contain a receptor known as beta 1 receptor. On beta 1 receptor, when sympathetic discharge releases noradrenaline, it releases renin. And this renin will try to increase blood sodium level and increases the blood volume so that the blood supply to the brain is maintained. Now, clonidine and alpha-methyldopa, they are central sympatholytic. Clonidine and methyldopa, they are central sympatholytic. They decrease the sympathetic discharge from the brain. Hence, they decrease renin activity. Now, atenolol C is a beta blocker. Atenolol blocks the beta 1 receptor present on Jg cells of the kidney, hence atenolol also decreases renin activity. Now chlorothiazide is a diuretic. It's a thiazide diuretic. Now thiazide diuretic or any other diuretic, they decrease blood sodium level. As they decrease blood sodium level, it increases sympathetic discharge. And rather, it increases renin activity. So the correct answer for the question number 6 is chlorothiazide. They rather decrease blood sodium level, which in turn increases plasma renin activity. Now question number 7, lente insulin is composed of 30% amorphous, 70% crystalline. 30% crystalline, 70% amorphous, same as NPH, only 70% amorphous. The correct answer for the question number 7 is A. 30% amorphous, 70% crystalline. Now let's see what are the different preparations of insulin. What are the different preparations of insulin? Insulin, they are divided into ultra short, also known as rapid, short acting, intermediate acting and long acting. Now what are the different insulin? In ultra short we have lispro, aspart and glulisine. Overall lispro is the shortest acting. In short we have regular insulin and amorphous insulin, which is also known as semilente. In intermediate, we have NPH, stand for neutral protamine histone. And in long, we have detemir, glargine, degludec. Degludec overall is the longest acting. And we have crystalline insulin. In long, crystalline insulin is also known as ultralente insulin. Ultralente insulin. Now, 70% of long acting insulin, crystalline insulin, and 30% of short acting insulin or semilente insulin amorphous, 30% of amorphous and 70% of crystalline insulin is known as lente insulin. And this lente insulin itself is an intermediate acting insulin. So lente insulin is an intermediate acting insulin, which is a mixture of short acting 30% amorphous and long acting 70% crystalline insulin or ultralente insulin. So the correct answer for question number 7 is A. 30% amorphous, 70% crystalline. Question number 8. Which of the following is the first indication of distribution of a drug into the tissue? The correct answer for question number 8 is A. That is large volume of distribution. Now large volume of distribution, is also known as VD. It is denoted by VD. So when we give, what is VD stand for or volume of distribution stand for? It is the extra vascular deposition of a drug or distribution of a drug. Okay, so the volume of distribution is extravascular deposition or distribution of a drug. So if a drug is having high volume of distribution, the drug will be deposited more into the tissue. So this is the first indication which determines the distribution of a drug into the tissue. On which factors volume of distribution depends? Volume of distribution is directly proportional to the lipid solubility of a drug. Lipid solubility of a drug, which is determined by the pK value of a drug. It is inversely proportional to the plasma protein binding. It is inversely proportional to the plasma protein binding. If a drug is bound more to the plasma protein, it will not get deposited into the tissue. And if a drug is highly lipid soluble, it will cross the blood endothelial cell and get deposited into the various tissue. So the correct answer for question number 8 is A, large volume of distribution. Now question number 9, which of the following disease modifying anti-rheumatoid drug act by causing extracellular accumulation of adenosine? So they are discussing about DMARD, disease modifying anti-rheumatoid drug. Let's see what is their mechanism of action. The first, the drug is leflunomide. As second is azathioprine, third is hydroxychloroquine and methotrexate. The correct answer for question number 9, the drug which causes accumulation of adenosine outside the cell is methotrexate. The correct answer for question number 9 is methotrexate. Let's see the mechanism of action of all these disease modifying anti-rheumatoid drug. Leflunomide, the mechanism of action is it inhibits dihydroorotate dehydrogenase, which in turn decreases pyrimidine synthesis. Azathioprine, it inhibits one enzyme known as HGPRTase enzyme, which in turn decreases guanine production. HGPRTs, hydroxychloroquine, it inhibit interleukin 1 and it causes lysosomal stabilization. And methotrexate, it has the broadest spectrum, it has a very broad spectrum of mechanism of action. Let's see what is the mechanism of action of methotrexate. It inhibit dihydrofolate reductase enzyme. It also inhibit thymidylate synthase enzyme. So it inhibit dihydrofolate reductase, it inhibit thymidylate synthase, it also causes efflux of adenosine or extracellular deposition of adenosine. And this adenosine, which is outside the cell, is a very important immunosuppressive drug. It inhibit interleukin 1, it inhibit complement pathway, and it also inhibit natural killer cells. Hence, they decrease inflammatory reactions in rheumatoid arthritis. So the mechanism of action of methotrexate is it causes efflux of adenosine and extravascular deposition of adenosine. The correct answer for question number 9 is methotrexate. Now let's come to the next question. Question number 10. Which of the following drug is an antidote for fibrinolytic therapy? So the antidote for fibrinolytic therapy is antifibrinolytic drugs. The antidote for fibrinolytic therapy is also known as antifibrinolytic drugs. There are three antifibrinolytic drugs. The first is epsilon amino caproic acid. Second is tranexamic acid, which is the most potent. And last is eprotinin, which is now not used. So the correct answer for question number 10th is epsilon amino caproic acid. Now what is protamine? Protamine is an antidote for heparin. Heparin, it is an anticoagulant. And streptokinase is a fibrinolytic. So the correct answer for question number 10th is epsilon amino caproic acid. Let's come to the question number 11th. A patient is administered 200 milligram of a drug. 75 milligram of this drug is excreted in 90 minutes. That means when we have given 200 milligram of a drug to a patient, 75 milligram of this drug is removed out of the body in 90 minutes. So the remaining drug is 125 milligram. If the drug follows first order kinetics, how much of the drug will be left after 6 hours? Now remember, when a drug follows first order kinetics, the half-life of a drug is constant. And even in each half-life, 50% of the drug is eliminated out of the body. 50% of the drug is removed in one half-life of a body. Now, if you want to calculate the half-life of a drug will be from when the first half-life will be when only 100 milligram of the drug is remaining while 100 milligram of the drug is removed. So this is the first half-life. Now we know that 75 milligram of the drug is removed in 90 minutes. So we can easily calculate that 100 milligram of this drug will be removed in, that will be 90 divided by 75 into 100. It will come out to be 120 minutes. 120 minutes or 2 hours. That means in 2 hours, 100 milligram of the drug will be removed from 200. If 100 milligram of the drug is removed in 2 hours, can we say the half-life of a drug is 2 hours? The half-life of a drug is 2 hour because 50% of the drug is removed in 2 hours. Now, as we know that the half-life of a drug is constant in first order kinetics, so in next 2 hours, 50 milligram of the drug will be remaining and 50 milligram will be removed. And if we talk about further, in next 2 hours, 25 milligram of the drug will be remaining and 25 milligram will be removed. So here the half-life is constant. In the first half-life, 100, in the second half-life, 50, and after the third half-life, 25 milligram of the drug will be removed. Now the question is asking how much of the drug will be remaining after 6 hours. If we talk about 6 hours, 2 hours plus 2 hours plus 2 hours is 6 hours. So after 6 hours, 25 milligram of the drug will be remaining in the body, and overall 175 milligram of the drug will be removed. So the correct answer for the question number 11 is 25 milligram. So after 6 hours, 25 milligram of the drug will be remaining in the body. Now let's come to the question number 12. Protease inhibitor act on which of the following processes in human immune virus or HIV virus? A. Viral assembly, pro-viral RNA synthesis, C. Viral entry into the cell, or DNA synthesis from RNA. The correct answer, protease inhibitor. They inhibit viral assembly. The correct answer for the question number 12 is A. Protease inhibitor, they inhibit viral assembly in cases of HIV virus. Now let's see what are the different anti-HIV drug and what is their mechanism of action. Now, if we talk about, there is a virus known as HIV virus, and it mainly affects human cell. Now, HIV virus, it contains various protein like GP41 and GP120, and it act on a receptors on a cell known as CXCR4 and CCR5, through which it enters into the cell. Now, there is a drug which is known as fusion inhibitor. Fusion inhibitor, they inhibit GP41 and GP120. The drug is enfuvirtide. We have a drug which inhibits CCR5. They are known as entry inhibitors. Entry inhibitors, they inhibit CCR5. The drug is maraviroc. and Vickery Virok. Now, when the HIV virus enters into the cell, HIV virus, it contains single-stranded RNA. It contains single-stranded RNA, and this single-stranded RNA, it gets converted into double-stranded DNA with the help of an enzyme reverse transcriptase. And hence we have a class of drug known as reverse transcriptase inhibitors. Reverse transcriptase inhibitor. When this DNA is synthesized, this DNA integrates with the host cell DNA. It integrates with the host cell DNA. Now the next class of drug we have is integrase inhibitor, which inhibit integration of viral DNA to the host cell DNA. Integrase inhibitor like elvitagravir, etc. They all end with the word gravir. Now after the DNA is integrated into the host cell, this virus synthesizes its all precursor protein. Precursor proteins are synthesized like GAG and POL protein. These precursor protein are needed for assembly of virus. With the help of a protein known as protease. These precursor protein uses a protein known as protease protein, which is needed for assembly of virus. So we have a class of drug known as protease inhibitor. Protease inhibitor inhibit assembly of virus. So protease inhibitor, they inhibit assembly of virus. So the correct answer for the question number 12 is viral assembly. Protease inhibitor, they inhibit viral assembly. Now let's come to the question number 13th. A 64-year man presents with difficulty in urinating and dribbling at the end of urination. Which of the following drugs would be most appropriate for treating this man condition? Now the patient, as you are seeing, the age of the patient is very old, 64 years. So in old age patient, we know the patient is having obstruction while urination. Because of this, there is dribbling of urine. We can easily assess that this patient is suffering from a disease known as BPH. BPH stands for benign prostatic hypertrophy, and the patient is having obstructive symptoms. Obstructive symptoms. Now the point is, we know that the prostate gland, it is located behind internal urethric sphincter. Due to the hypertrophy of prostate gland, there is closure of internal urethric sphincter. Because of this reason, the patient has obstructive symptoms like dribbling of urine. Now, what is the treatment, drug treatment of BPH? For BPH, we use two classes of drug. First, we use is alpha-1 blocker. The function of alpha-1 blocker is to open internal urethric sphincter. And we use 5-alpha reductase inhibitor. The function of 5-alpha reductase inhibitor is to decrease the size of prostate. Now what are the drugs? Among alpha-1 blocker, we have the drugs, non-specific drug like prazosin, terazosin, etc. And we have alpha-1A blocker like tamsulosin and celodosin. Now to decrease the size of prostate, we have 5-alpha reductase inhibitor. The drug is finasteride and dutasteride. We have a drug, finasteride and dutasteride. They decrease the size of prostate in cases of benign prostatic hyperplasia. Now the correct answer for the question number 13A is A, finasteride. Finasteride, it is used in BPH to decrease the size of the prostate. So the correct answer is A, finasteride. Now let's come to question number 14. A 33-year-old man receiving chemotherapy for testicular carcinoma develops the signs of renal tubular damage. Which of the following drug is most likely to be responsible for this nephrotoxicity? The correct answer for the question number 14, the classical side effect of nephrotoxicity is seen with cisplatin. The classical side effect of this chemotherapy is by cisplatin. Now let's see what are the common side effects of this chemotherapy. Now bleomycin, the characteristic side effect is pulmonary fibrosis. Plus it causes certain dermal skin toxicity like, it also causes skin toxicity like Raynaud's phenomena, dermatographism and ichthyosis. So the characteristic toxicity of bleomycin is pulmonary and skin toxicity. The characteristic toxicity of cisplatin is nephrotoxicity. And in nephrotoxicity, it may cause renal tubular damage. It may also cause glomerular damage. Now cyclophosphamide, the classical toxicity is hemorrhagic cystitis. It affects mainly bladder, and the classical toxicity of vinblastine is neurotoxicity. It is highly neurotoxic, plus it also causes paralytic ileus. So it mainly affects neurons, cyclophosphamide mainly affects bladder, cisplatin mainly affects kidney, and bleomycin mainly affects lungs, pulmonary fibrosis. So the answer for the question number 14, nephrotoxicity is cisplatin. Now let's come to the question number 15. All of the followings are the inhibitors of glucagon secretion except insulin, it inhibits glucagon. Hyperglycemia also inhibit glucagon. Somatostatin also inhibit glucagon. The correct answer is amino acid. Now let's see on what factors glucagon secretion depends. Glucagon secretion is stimulated by and inhibited by. Now glucagon, its secretion is stimulated by hypoglycemia stimulates glucagon secretion. Other are epinephrine. Third is amino acids, especially arginine and alanine. They stimulate glucagon secretion. Fourth, you will write acetylcholine. And fifth, you will write cholecystokinin. So these are the factors which stimulates glucagon secretion. Now the factors which inhibit glucagon secretions are hyperglycemia, insulin hormone, somatostatin hormone, fatty acids and ketones in the blood, and urea. These are the factors which inhibit glucagon secretion. So the correct answer for the question number 15th, all are the inhibitors of glucagon except that is amino acid. Amino acid rather stimulates glucagon secretion. Now let's come to the question number 16th. The question number 16th, idiosyncratic side effect of carbamazepine are all except Stevens-Johnson, agranulocytosis, rash and blood vision. The correct answer is D, blood vision. Now, what do we mean by idiosyncratic reaction? Idiosyncratic reaction is type B adverse drug reaction. That means it is idiopathic. We don't know when it occurs. It is genetically determined. It is dose independent. We don't know in which dose it may occur. It is dose independent. Now, if we talk about idiosyncratic reaction, Stevens-Johnson, agranulocytosis and rashes, they are idiosyncratic reactions. They may occur suddenly. We don't know in which person they occur, and they occur at any dose. While if we talk about blood vision, it is the dose dependent adverse effect of carbamazepine. And it mainly occurs due to neurotoxicity involving optic nerve, due to optic nerve damage. So the dose dependent adverse effect of carbamazepine is blood vision. Now let's come to the question number 17. Which of the following is a substrate of P-glycoprotein? Now what is P-glycoprotein? P-glycoprotein is an efflux transporter. That means when a drug enters into the cell, this P-glycoprotein causes efflux of a drug. Because of this reason, it is the main transporters which confers resistance to a particular drug. So most of the drug, if they are a substrate of P-glycoprotein, if P-glycoprotein identifies that drug, this drug is effluxed out of the cell and the drug will not produce effect and the resistance to the drug will come. We will write it is ATP dependent transporter. It requires energy and it is also known as multi-drug resistance transporter. It is also known as MDR transporter. MDR stands for multi-drug resistance transporter. Now, there are various drugs which are substrate of P-glycoprotein. There are various drugs which increases the activity of P-glycoprotein, known as inducers. And there are various drugs which decreases the activity of P-glycoprotein, which are known as P-glycoprotein inhibitors. Now let's see what are the substrate of P-glycoprotein. The substrate of P-glycoprotein is digoxin, cyclosporin, itraconazole, which is given in the answer, verapamil, and quinidine. Inducers of P-glycoprotein we will write is rifampicin and St. John Wort. And inhibitor are cimetidine, erythromycin, ketoconazole. And none of them is shown by azithromycin. Azithromycin neither a substrate nor it is an inducer or inhibitor. So by focusing on this list of the drugs among substrate of P-glycoprotein, inducers of P-glycoprotein and inhibitor of P-glycoprotein, now we can mark our answer. Now, which of the following drug is a substrate of P-glycoprotein? Azithromycin, none. Neither it is a substrate, nor it is an inducer, nor it is an inhibitor. Ketoconazole, it is an inhibitor. Rifampicin, it is an inducer. While if we talk about इट्राकोनाजोल, इट्राकोनाजोल इज अ सबस्ट्रेट फॉर पी ग्लाइकोप्रोटीन. सो द करेक्ट आंसर फॉर द क्वेश्चन नंबर 17 इज इट्राकोनाजोल. इट्राकोनाजोल इज अ सबस्ट्रेट फॉर पी ग्लाइकोप्रोटीन, वाइल कीटोकोनाजोल इज एन इनहिबिटर, रिफैम्पिसिन इज एन इंड्यूसर, एजिथ्रोमाइसिन इज नन ऑफ द बिलो मेंशनड. इट्राकोनाजोल इज अ सबस्ट्रेट. नाउ लेट्स कम टू द क्वेश्चन नंबर 18. A 70-year-old hypertensive patient with chronic kidney disease, stage 5, recently diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. He does not want to take injectable insulin. Which of the following hypoglycemic agent will be preferred in this patient who won't require renal dose modification? So we have to find out the drug which is safe in renal failure. We have to find a drug which is safe in anti-diabetic drug which is safe in renal failure. The two main classes of the drugs which are safe in renal failure, the first is linagliptin, and the second drug which is found to be safe in renal failure is pioglitazone. So the correct answer for the question number 18th is linagliptin. Linagliptin is safe in renal failure. Why? Because it is excreted through bile. It does not need excretion out of the body through urine. So in cases of renal failure, it is given, but it is excreted through bile. Vildagliptin. Vildagliptin is unsafe in both renal and hepatic failure. Now these two classes of drug are also known as DPP-4 inhibitor. Now the third drug we have is repaglinide. Repaglinide is an insulin secretagogue. It causes release of insulin. We will write it is safe in hepatic failure. Why? Because it is excreted out in urine. So hence it is unsafe in renal failure. And the last is glimepiride, which is a sulfonylurea. It is contraindicated or unsafe in both hepatic and renal failure. Like vildagliptin, it is also unsafe in hepatic and renal failure. So linagliptin is safe in renal failure, which is the correct answer for this question. Repaglinide is safe in hepatic failure. Vildagliptin and glimepiride, they are unsafe in both hepatic as well as renal failure. Now the question number 19th. A drug X was given a continuous infusion of 1.6 milligram per minute. The clearance of a drug is 640 ml per minute. What is the, with a half-life of 1.8 hours, what would be the steady state plasma concentration of a drug? Now what is steady state concentration? Steady state concentration, it is also known as plateau principle. Plateau principle. Now steady state or plateau principle concentration of a drug, it means when we give a drug continuously, after a certain point of time, if we give a drug continuously, after a certain point of the time, the concentration of a drug in plasma becomes constant. It becomes constant, it does not fluctuate. This concentration of a drug is known as steady state concentration, also known as CSS. It is also known as CSS. Now the point is, what is the formula of steady state concentration? This steady state concentration, either it depends upon the loading dose divided by volume of distribution, or it depends upon maintenance dose divided by clearance capacity of an organ. So the formula of steady state concentration is either loading dose divided by volume of distribution or maintenance dose divided by clearance capacity. Now the point is, if we see the question, a drug is given by continuous intravenous infusion. That means the drug is continuously going into the body. We have not given any extra amount of the drug. So we are not concerned here about the loading dose. This continuous infusion is also known as maintenance dose here, which is equivalent to maintenance dose. And the clearance capacity of an organ is also given. The clearance capacity is also given. That is 640 ml. So we can apply this formula. We can apply the formula. We know the maintenance dose. We know the clearance capacity. So by applying the formula, 1.6, which is the maintenance dose, milligram per minute, and clearance capacity of an organ, that is 640 ml per minute, we can easily calculate steady state concentration of the drug. It comes out to be, if you calculate, it will come out to be 0.0025 milligram per ml. Milligram per ml. So the correct answer is 0.0025. So by seeing the options, the option C seems to be most apt. The correct answer for question number 19 is C, that is 0.002 milligram per ml. Now the last question, question number 20. An extensive infection with trichophyton rubrum would be best treated with. Now this trichophyton rubrum, it is a type of superficial, it causes superficial fungal infection of the skin, which is also known as dermatophytosis. Dermatophytosis. Now, what is the treatment of dermatophytosis? In mild to moderate cases and in severe to widespread lesion. In mild to moderate cases, we give topical antifungal agent. While in severe and widespread diseases, we give systemic antifungal. Now, topical antifungal like topical miconazole cream, we give tolneftate. They all are topical agent. Tolneftate. We give topical nystatin. These are the agents which are used as a topical antifungal drug. While in severe cases, we give oral greciofulvin. We give oral greciofulvin. We give oral azoles like fluconazole. We give terbinafine. These are the agents which are used in widespread agent. The reason is it they agents, systemic agents, which are given orally are more effective. They are more effective agents. Now, keeping this thing, the treatment of dermatophytosis in the mind, let's see, there is an extensive infection or a widespread infection. So if there is a widespread or an extensive infection, we have to give systemic antifungals. So the correct answer for the question number 20 is griseofulvin. The correct answer for the question number is griseofulvin, because these agents are topical, systemic, and they are topical agent. So for extensive agents, we give systemic agent. The correct answer for question number 20 is griseofulvin. Now, thank you very much.